people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. The latest Indian sero survey has revealed that nearly two-thirds of the Indians have developed antibodies against the coronavirus. And while the country is consistently endeavoring to ramp up the vaccine production and its inoculation, it is also taking several measures, including exclusive women booths to community radio stations to debunk the vaccine hesitancy. Meanwhile, its Himalayan neighbor Nepal has rolled out single-dose Johnson & Johnson vaccine. The vulnerables will be jabbed first, followed by the adult population.
As many as 66% Indians have developed antibodies against the coronavirus, says the data released by the government from a survey of 29,000 people across the nation in June and July. The fourth national serum survey that also included children aged between 6 and 17 for the first time also revealed that 50% of them were seropositive. The report comes at a time when India is witnessing a slowdown in daily infections and an uptick in the vaccine inoculation. Barring the southern state of Kerala and the western state of Maharashtra, the situation has stabilized as of now in the rest of the country. However, the government has urged all to be on their toes to prevent a third wave of the pandemic.
One out of three. Wherever you are, out of three of you, one is still vulnerable, and therefore the pandemic is in no way over. Second wave is still persisting. The danger of new outbreaks is very much there.
The country of over 1.3 billion people with 944 million to be vaccinated, the vaccine hesitancy was also a challenge for the government. Several education campaigns coupled with incentives have managed to convince a number of them to join the pro-vaccination fold. The government is also setting up a system where the conventional Indian women do not hesitate to get the jab. A pink booth in the northern Jammu and Kashmir is on those lines. Individuals too have joined in the fight to keep the pandemic at bay. A community radio station in India's northern Haryana state is working to debunk coronavirus misinformation and ease concerns about vaccination over its airwaves. The station has brought in experts, doctors and COVID-19 survivors to help people better understand the dangers of the virus.
लोगों को पता नहीं था किस तरीके से लॉकडाउन होगा ये बीमारी क्या है क्या कोरोना है लेकिन उस पे हमने जो एक्सपर्ट्स हैं डॉक्टर्स हैं उनको अपने रेडियो तक लेकर आए और लोगों तक इन्फॉर्मेशन हम बार बार पहुंचाए थे कि आप कैसे बचाव करेंगे क्या ये बीमारी है क्या इसके लक्षण हैं और उसके बाद जब वैक्सीन आ गई तो लोगों को बहुत सारी वैक्सीन को लेकर भी लोगों के मन में भय था कि अगर हम वैक्सीन लगवाएंगे तो बांझ हो जाएंगे बच्चे नहीं होंगे आगे चल के वैक्सीन लगवाए तो धीरे धीरे आप मर जाएंगे जो इस तरीके की बातें निकल गाती जो सोशल मीडिया पर आम रही हर तरीके की अफवाहें तो रेडियो में बात ने हर सवाल को नोट किया
India aims to inoculate its entire adult population by December end this year and has so far administered over 420 million doses, highest by any democratic country where the data has been shared transparently. Meanwhile, its Himalayan neighbor Nepal has rolled out Johnson & Johnson's single-shot vaccine. Kathmandu has received 1.5 million Johnson & Johnson vaccine doses through COVAX, the international vaccine sharing arrangement.
अब कुछ ठीक हो तेरे पे है ठीक हो तर अब जस जो कोरोना को महामारी अब जिस बच्च आशा लगी अब अलग ढुक्कु भनऊ न खोपला.
The country has decided to inoculate more vulnerable people first, including the differently abled people, refugees and sanitation workers. The Johnson & Johnson is the third vaccine to be approved in the country after Kathmandu cleared India-manufactured Covishield and China's Vericel.
Moving on. Pakistan has been meting out atrocities on people of illegally occupied territories of POK and Gilgit-Baltistan. And while a brazen exploitation and plunder was on for the past 7 decades, it is now carrying out human rights violations with impunity. Anybody who dissents is subject to intimidation and arrests. Recently, people held protests against the establishment for framing 2 human rights activists and putting them behind bars for merely questioning indiscriminate presence of the army in the region. If you're wondering where these people's fundamental rights are, well, they don't exist at all.
Streets filled with hundreds of placards carrying protesters are becoming an increasingly common sight in illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan. People are demanding the release of their leaders and social activists who have been framed and put behind bars at the instructions of Islamabad. The latest names in the list of hundreds who have been arbitrarily picked over the years are Mansoor Parvana and Hasnain Rummel. Mansoor Parvana was targeted for questioning Pakistan's intent behind an indiscriminate expansion of army cantonments in the region.
कभी हसनैन रमल को गिरफ्तार करे, कभी मंजूर परवाना को, कभी किसी और को, कभी किसी और को. ये तरीके जो कौमी काज के लिए आवाज उठाते हैं, इनको कब तक उठाते रहेंगे? ये मुमकिन नहीं है. इसलिए हुकूमत पाकिस्तान के इदारों को अपनी पॉलिसियों में तब्दीली लाना होगा, वरना हम इनकी तबाही, बर्बादी और इन जो जालिम जाबिर कुवतें हैं जो जाबराना फैसले करते हैं, नाइंसाफियां करते हैं, सहूलतकारियां करते हैं, इन सब के लिए हम फिर बच्चों को लेके दोनों हाथ उठा के दुआएं करेंगे, आमाल करेंगे कि इनकी तबाही बर्बादी हो.
Although Parvana was released after a sustained online and an offline campaign, Rummel continues to languish in prison even today. Hasnain Rummel had given up the government job perks to join the movement of people against Pakistan's exploitation of the region. He was fighting for the region's rights. Locals say the ISI and the army, which keep a constant vigil at the socio-political developments of the region, had marked him days before he was arrested. And while Pakistani agencies are arbitrarily arresting the activists and dissenters, it has given a free hand to the terrorists operating in the region, who in return endeavour to fulfil Islamabad's agenda of repressing locals and spreading terror in India.
वाज़ा है कि यहाँ पर बड़े बड़े दहशतगर्द, बड़े बड़े कातिल आजादाना घूम रहे हैं, बल्कि बहुत सारे कातिल, बहुत सारे दहशतगर्द हुकूमती जिम्मेदारों के प्रोटोकॉल में है.
While the region of Gilgit-Baltistan has been accorded a second-class treatment for years, the designs have grown even more sinister lately. A comprehensive strategy of driving out locals to alter the demography of the region was already in place for past years, and now the illegal incorporation of the region into Pakistan has paved way for an even stricter control of Pakistan in the region.
मेरे इस लूट मार को जारी रखने के लिए मुझे 74 साल से आईनी हुकूक से महरूम लटका के रखा गया है. मेरी हक हाकिमियत पर ढाका, मेरी हक मिल्कियत पर ढाका सिर्फ गिलगित बल्तिस्तान के वसाइल को लूटने के लिए. अगर हमसे जरा सी भी हमदर्दी है तो क्यों नहीं दिया जाता हमें कश्मीर तरस का सेटअप? कभी अबूरी आईनी ना सूबे के नाम से हमें बेवकूफ बनाया जाता है।
ये लाठी खाकर जिंदा है, ये गोली खाकर जिंदा है।
Protesters have, however, warned that if their demands of releasing the activists and other political demands are not met this time, they are going to intensify their movement and will not give up under any social or political pressure.
Moving on, the security situation in Afghanistan is not just worsening, it is collapsing. While the Afghan National Army has barely put up a fight, the Taliban are capturing large swathes of territories at an unprecedented pace. Almost all the US troops, barring those protecting their embassy and the airport, have left the country. Kabul and the international community have urged for a ceasefire, but that seems highly unlikely in the current scenario when the Taliban are under the impression that they are close to achieving their mission of ruling the country once again.
سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر.
Not one but three rockets landed near Afghan presidential palace in capital Kabul when the country's top leadership, including President Ashraf Ghani and Vice President Amrullah Saleh, was offering Eid al-Adha prayers. While no rocket landed inside the compound and everybody remained unhurt, this Taliban dare has rung alarm bells and have triggered fear all around. Writing is on the wall. Taliban are back and they are cruising towards their aim of toppling the democratic government, which according to them is American puppet. And while it continues to make territorial gains, the start-stop peace talk being held in Doha haven't shown any progress. The Taliban accuse the government of not meeting their demands. Kabul, on the other hand, says the insurgents have no positive outlook and are deliberately keeping the talks in impasse mode. President Ashraf Ghani lambasted the militant organization for not showing any willingness to improve the situation in the country. He even regretted his government's decision of releasing 5,000 Taliban prisoners as a goodwill gesture to go ahead with the peace negotiations. The international community, which according to the experts has failed people and the government of Afghanistan, has urged the insurgents to hold a ceasefire. 15 diplomatic missions and the NATO representative in Kabul joined hands to urge the Taliban to halt military offensives across Afghanistan. Kabul says it has reached out to the Taliban despite being criticized at different levels because all it wants is peace and stability.
از مصیبت ادامه جنگ مردم افغانستان در گوشه‌های مختلف کشور رنج می‌برند. امروز در چندین ولایت افغانستان جنگ با شدت دوام دارد. اما سوال شما خواهد بود که جنگ با شدت دوام داره، شما میرین درباره صلح گپ میزنین؟ بله، چون جنگ با شدت دوام داره، چون این جنگ تنها امروز نیست، 42 سال است که در این کشور ما ادامه داشته و صدها هزار نفر قربانی از مردم ما گرفته، باید ما کوشش خود برای تامین صلح بکنیم.
95% of US troops have already left the country and the remaining 5 will leave by 31st August, the rescheduled date of complete withdrawal. Experts have speculated that the Taliban will capture the entire country in 6 months of US departure. The pace of their current progress can make it happen even before that. And while the people around the world are blaming Washington for the deteriorating situation in the war-torn country, the US veterans too have joined the chorus.
"100% we lost the war. I mean, the Taliban already taken over one of the major passes like this week, and getting money from this choke point of Tajikistan. So, and we're not even out yet. Like, the Taliban will take over. It's who's going to be there to stop them, you know? Like, so the whole point was to get rid of the Taliban. We didn't do that. I mean, really make it really simple. Did we do that? No.
The Taliban return is going to be catastrophic. People fear their lives and livelihood. Hundreds of thousands of them have already left their homes to save their lives. The UN Refugee Agency estimates 270,000 Afghans have been displaced inside the country since January, bringing the number of people forced from their homes to more than 3.5 million. An international support is what Afghanistan seeks and is in need of. Russians, among others, are in talks and have already moved their tanks along its border with Tajikistan. But who can take a call to have a military foot on the Afghan soil to protect civilians and the government is still a long shot.
And now in our section of Asia This Week, the story is from across the continent that made news this week.
Exiled Tibetans in India's northern hill town of Dharamsala have time and again staged protests against Beijing for illegally occupying their region for past many decades. A similar candlelight vigil to condemn it was also held last week on World Day of International Justice. Tibetans with candles, banners, posters and flags marched on the streets and sang as they tried to highlight the atrocities being committed by the Chinese government. China sent troops into remote mountainous Tibet in 1950 in what is official terms as peaceful liberation and has ruled there with an iron fist ever since. India has given them shelter since then, from where they raised their voice against Beijing. Yokohama is a beautiful city that attracts visitors from around the world. Located at a 30-minute distance from Tokyo Station, it can also be reached through train from Haneda Airport. Tourists enjoy various events and exciting recreational facilities in Yokohama throughout the year. Despite COVID-19 pandemic, the city has developed another major attraction. From April, Yokohama City started operation of Yokohama Air Cabin. This is the first ropeway setting in city area.
世界でも珍しいと思うんですけれども、リチウムイオンバッテリーを積み込んでおりまして、それに伴いましてレーボ装置というのがついております。それと夜間照明用の電源も確保しておりますし、各種安全装置というのを電源を持つことによってできる設置することができます。
Yokohama Air Cabin carries passengers from landside Sakurgi Station to the harbor area back and forth. The rope covers a distance of 630 meters, one way on a height of 40 meters. The battery is charged in short waiting terms. Lighting decoration also pleases the eyes. Every passenger is satisfied overlooking Minato Mirai District, which has famous place as Cosmo Clock and landmark tower with floating feeling like a bird. Passenger can enjoy it in the daytime and night time. Yokohama City never stopped to stir up visitors' excitement. Okutama Town is located at the northwestern tip of Tokyo. It is a popular tourist destination known as the backyard of Tokyo. A 90-minute ride on the train from Shinjuku Station, many visitors come here to enjoy a number of adventure sports like kayaking, rafting, and hiking. Along the river, there are many resting stops like restaurants, shops, and cafes offering light meal and refreshment.
まあ、東京都内からだいたい1時間から1時間半ぐらいで、の場所でございまして、東京のまあ西の外れですね。
ご覧の通り、まあ、こういったあの緑に囲まれた非常にいい場所でございます。やはりこの多摩川の、ね、奥多摩の自然に囲まれた、水のいい場所でございまして、この水がお酒造りには大変重要なポイントなんですね。
The area has many water sources like Lake Okutama, which is a source of water supply for Tokyo, providing a total of 180 million tons of water, of which about 20% of the water is used by the citizens of Tokyo. In the clear water, the reflection of the trees and the surrounding mountains could be seen. People bring their kids to enjoy water activities or choose to walk along the river that to have a relaxing experience. It is the perfect destination for family and tourists to have relaxing experience in the lap of nature.
Moving on to our culture section, Muslims across South Asia and the world celebrated Eid al-Adha, a major Islamic festival marked by mass congregations and feasting. This festival of joy is believed to bring peace as people let go of past grudges and make meaningful connections with one another. The festival, which otherwise is marked with great fanfare, was a low-key affair this year due to prevailing COVID fear.
The festival of Eid al-Adha brings along with it teachings of sacrifice, love, dedication and belief. As part of the celebrations, people dress up in new clothes and head out of their homes early in the morning to offer prayers, sacrifice an animal, usually a goat or a sheep, and feast with family and friends. In India's capital, New Delhi, devotees prayed at the iconic Jama Masjid, Asia's largest mosque, on the occasion. To prevent overcrowding, entry was restricted at the mosque and only people living in the mosque complex were allowed to offer prayers.
जामे मस्जिद जो पूरी तरह भरी रहती थी, बाहर भी हजारों लोग हुआ करते थे. हमने भी यही तय किया कि हमें भी इसको एहतियात रखनी है और एक मिसाल पेश करनी है और दूसरों को मैसेज भी देना है कि जामे मस्जिद को आम नमाजियों के लिए बंद रखकर सिर्फ वही लोग नमाज अदा करें जो जामे मस्जिद में रहते हैं, जामे मस्जिद कम्प्लेक्स में. तो आज भी यहाँ तकरीबन 15-20 लोगों ने ही ईद उल अदा की नमाज अदा की.
Pakistan's Karachi city was soaked in festive spirits as the city celebrated the festival with grandeur. People celebrated the festival with mosque prayers, animal sacrifice and exchange of greetings. With the spread of the coronavirus Delta variant reaching alarming levels in Asia, congregations at mosque and prayer grounds were asked to strictly follow COVID-19 protocols.
इस्लाम में तो इंसान को डर खौफ रखना ही नहीं चाहिए, लेकिन कोरोना की हिफाजती तदाबीर हैं उसको अमल करना चाहिए. मास्क लगा के रखना चाहिए, सैनिटाइज़र वगैरह रखना चाहिए. अभी जिस तरह बता रहे हैं कि मुल्की हालात में कोरोना की चौथी लहर बहुत तेज़ी से आ रही है, तो लोग काफ़ी अमवात हो रही हैं. तो बेहतर है कि आप अपने घर में रहें, अपने बच्चों को और अपने घर में सेफ्टी इख्तियार करें, मास्क वगैरह पहने. अगर बाहर जाएँ तो मास्क वगैरह पहन के जाएँ, सैनिटाइज़र इस्तेमाल करें. और बाकी ये है कि आवाम को हुकूमत का साथ देना चाहिए इस मामले में. हर वक्त जो है इंसान को कोई रिस्क नहीं लेना चाहिए, क्योंकि ज़िंदगी जो मौत वो अल्लाह ताला के हाथ में है, लेकिन आपको सेफ्टी भी रखनी चाहिए.
In Bangladesh, a large number of people travel to their hometowns and native villages to celebrate Eid al-Adha. Authorities in Bangladesh hit a pause on the lockdown measures to facilitate people traveling home to celebrate the festival. Meanwhile, India and Bangladesh border forces exchanged sweets in India's eastern border town of Fulbari in West Bengal state as they followed the tradition of presenting each other with sweets on key festivals.
आज के दिन ईद का त्यौहार है, ईद फेस्टिवल है, उस पे हम लोगों ने बांग्लादेश बॉर्डर गार्डिंग फोर्स को मिठाई देकर के पूरे पीजीबी को और बांग्लादेशियों को शुभकामनाएं दी है.
अकॉर्डिंग टू रिलीजियस बिलीव्स, द फेस्टिवल आल्सो कोइंसाइड्स विद द एनिवर्सरी ऑफ द डे व्हेन द कुरान वाज डिक्लेयर्ड कंप्लीट एंड देयरफॉर मेनी मुस्लिम्स अंडरटेक हज, एन इंपॉर्टेंट एनुअल इस्लामिक पिलग्रिमेज टू द होली सिटी ऑफ मक्का इन सऊदी अरेबिया.
The festival of Eid al-Adha symbolizes our willingness to give up and sacrifice our dear belongings and to strengthen ties of friendship and help those in need. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.